Marshall, we're joined by Tom Klein, attorney for victim number five and survivor number five. He joins me now. Tom, I assume you talked to your client tonight. How is he doing? How does he feel about what happened?
I texted him. I've been on the grounds here. It's almost impossible. In fact, it has been impossible to get a text signal out. He and I have gone back and forth yesterday. We talked about how he's gotten through this with the support of his family, his girlfriend, his close friends. He's a wonderful young man. He's tried to live a normal life through this. This was a case, Anderson, so many of these young men, where the police showed up at their door. They didn't seek this out. They had these horrible memories in their, buried in their soul, and they came forward because they were literally forced to come forward. He viewed this as an obligation of citizenship. He still does. He anxiously awaited the verdict, and as soon as I get done literally talking to you and a few others, I'm going to, I'm sure, talk to him.
And how difficult was the trial? How difficult was getting up on that stand facing Jerry Sandusky?
Well, I can tell you, I saw every stitch of the testimony in this trial, including my client. He took the stand. It was very difficult. He told me so. He described to me how he took the stand as a victim of childhood abuse, now a young man leading a productive life. And he came in, he sat down, he looked towards Mr. Sandusky, and he told me that Mr. Sandusky was staring back at him the entire time. There was an awkward moment during my client's testimony, which I think is illustrative of Mr. Sandusky himself. There was a brief story in the warm-up to these horrible, dastardly events that took place where my client was describing how he met Mr. Sandusky. He's a young man of Polish descent. Mr. Sandusky was playing a Polish gangster in a skit, and they engaged in a conversation about it. Sandusky literally, I saw this with my own eyes, looked at my client almost adoringly. I thought it was awkward, odd, I thought telling. I didn't see any of the same towards his family. I thought the elephant in this room, which could not escape this jury's attention, was Dottie Sandusky, and how there wasn't an inch of testimony, a millimeter of testimony, about any affection or normal relations that he had with her or he had with his six children, who also were absent as witnesses.
In terms of what happens now, I mean, the defense, I talked to Joe Amendola, who's saying, well, they're going to look at what the issues for appeal are, and he feels good about things they can raise up on appeal. Do you buy any of that? I mean, do you worry about that at all?
I don't worry about it a bit. I was here from the beginning to the end. I've been following every legal ruling and everything here. Joe Amendola was on the courthouse steps retrying his case. His case was largely that this was a conspiracy among the prosecutors, the police, the trial lawyers, and the media, all of whom conspired to get this man. That's not the case at all. The fact of the matter is that this man was guilty. The record, from what I see, is clean, and I would expect that he now spends the rest of his life in jail.
Tom Klein, I appreciate you being on with us tonight, and our best to your client and his family. We're going to take a quick break. We're going to continue to be live to the top of the hour. More from our panel, legal experts, just ahead.